is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. We greet you in the name of our risen Lord this morning. We are so glad to have you. And I invite you now to greet and welcome one another with the traditional Easter greeting. Just a few things I'd like to share with you before we begin to worship. If you are visiting with us and at some time during the service you need or want to use the nursery, it is through these doors and right straight ahead. For a restroom, probably the best would be to go to the back of the church and around the cloister, and right near the gathering space there are restrooms. And then I would invite you to please put your phones on silent.
And then just a couple notes. Well, why don't you, if you're on the ends of the pews, grab and sign the friendship pads so you know who you're sitting next to, and just pass them up and down the pews. Just a couple notes about worship today. On the first hymn, you'll note that we, the congregation, sing verses 1, 3, and 5, and the choir is going to do 2 and 4, so just pay attention to that. And then for the closing, if you would like to be part of the group that goes up and sings the Hallelujah Chorus, just during the final couple verses of our closing hymns, just sort of drift on up there. There's music up there for you, so you're invited to do that. Let us worship God. Is in the name of the Lord, who creates the heavens and the earth. Glory to you, O God. On this day you raised Christ to new life. triumphing over sin and death. Glory to you, O Christ. On this day, you are alive forever, opening to us the gates of everlasting life. Glory to you, O Holy Spirit. On this day, you fill us with hope and brighten us with unspeakable joy. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Beloved in the Lord, trusting in God's immeasurable grace, let us turn together in confession, praying first in silence and then joining together. Let us pray. Together. Almighty, all-loving God, you raised Jesus from the dead, and everything was changed. You gave us a hope greater than our imaginings. You triumphed in a way that is much more than wins and losses. You gave new life that is far beyond more of the same. You showed us a future that exceeds our comprehension. You have demolished our explanations. You have surpassed our expectations. Still, all we have are our inadequate words to praise you. All we have are our small minds and frail hearts to love you. Take us as we are. Meet us where we are, on the road and at our tables, in the garden and among our tasks. Fill us, body and soul, with the undying love and the everlasting life of Jesus Christ. All praise and glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God in perfect community, forever and ever. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Amen. These words of assurance and pardon. When dying on the cross, Jesus prayed this prayer: Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are dying. In this prayer, Jesus also prays for us. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God in the highest. The gospel frees us to live new and holy lives. So hear also how you are called to live. For freedom, Christ has set you free. But do not use your freedom as an excuse for self-indulgence. Instead, in love, serve one another. True freedom is to love others as you have yourself. So live freely, animated and motivated by the Holy Spirit within you. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Thank you.
Amen. Children, will you come and join us up here, please? Oh, well, worse good. Sawyer, come sit next to me. I won't bite you. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Has it been a good Easter so far?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah? I hope so. Hey, do you know on Easter we say these words back and forth a lot? Have you been paying attention? We say something and you say something back. What do we say at Easter? Who can tell me? Christ is risen, and then you say back?
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Okay. Well, you know, this week, I thought, when did those words start, and how did we get those words? So I did, you know those words? I found out they have been using those words not for 10 or 20 years, and not even for 100 years. For thousands of years, Christians have been saying that back and forth. And then I found out, they didn't only say them at Easter. They used to say them when life got hard or tough and they were discouraged. Like, I've got two examples and we're going to practice one. So way, 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 way back when, Christians often got put in prison for being Christians. And they'd be lonely, hungry, nobody'd visit. But they knew on the other side of the wall, in the prison cell next door, was a Christian. So they would say, when they felt really at the bottom, Christ is risen. And what do you think the person in the cell next door would shout back?
He is.
Okay, so here's what we're going to do. You guys turn that way. Okay, everybody from here on over look that way. You guys all look this way. You guys are going to start. Now make sure, you feel really hungry and lonely and nobody has visited you or talked to you or seen you for 4 days. You're about as empty and disappointed as you can be. And you guys have to start it. And you guys over here, listen. What are you going to say?
He is risen indeed.
Okay, well, I guess that would get me through for a while in prison. The other one I thought we could do, I thought this too, they were sometimes slaves, I was told, and they had to row boats before they had engines. You ever seen these movies where these people are chained and they're sitting there going, have you ever done that? Have you ever done that at a gym on a rowing machine? Your parents have a rowing machine they never use in the basement? Yeah? Come on, you can get on it, okay? Let's all start rowing the boat. Now think you got to do this for the rest of the day, okay? And you're not going to get any food. Maybe you're going to get water at 4 o'clock this afternoon, just a little cup. You're very tired, super sore. The sun is hot. What are you going to say to the person chained next to you?
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. I think you guys could practice a little more at home. And what I really want you to do, I'm serious about this part. So maybe tomorrow you're riding to school and you're not feeling so good or your brother got yelled at. Just look over to him and say, Christ is risen. And see if they say back, Christ is risen indeed. Maybe when you get sent to the corner for a timeout, try looking up your parent and say, Christ is risen. See what they say. But use this not just on Easter, but every day to remind us, no matter how hard we have it, how lonely, how sick, how blue, how hungry, how sad we are, it's Christ is risen, and that's good news and changes everything. Okay, let's have a prayer. Can you find a hand to hold?
Here. Do you want to hold our hand?
Dear God, we thank you that Christ is risen, and no matter how hungry or sad or alone or in trouble we are, we always can find hope and comfort that Christ is risen indeed. So we ask that we would carry that love and share that comfort with our friends and our neighbors and our enemies and people all around the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we stand up and be blessed? Congregation, will you bless your children?
You are God's beloved.
Let us pray. Mighty God, now as we open the pages of an ancient book, we ask that by your Holy Spirit you would open our ears and our minds and our hearts, that we might receive new and life-giving words, even the word, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
From the book of the Law, Luke 24, 1 through 12. Early in the morning, the first day of the week, for they clean, the yom and them take the spice what they done been mix up, and they gone to Jesus' tomb. But when they get there, they see that the stone, what been a kibbutz door to the tomb, done been rolled back. So they gone inside, but they ain't find the Lord Jesus' body. They've been a wonder about what done happened when all of a sudden they see two men that stand up there will have on bright clothes what a shine. The yom and them been too scared, and they bow their head down to the ground. But the man them tell him, say, Una ain't out of look, yeah, amongst the dead people for a man what a lib, ain't he? Jesus ain't here. He done get up from amongst the dead and live again. Una, remember what he been a tell Una when he been there with Una in Galilee? They gwine take the man what come from God and hand him over to wickedy people what gwine kill him upon a cross. At a 3 day, he gwine get up from amongst the dead and live again. Then the omen them remember all that what Jesus been tell him. They left the tomb and gone back to town and tell the 11 apostle them and all the other people who had been a walk with Jesus about all that what happened. Them woman been Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary James' mother. Them and the other women who had been with them gone back to tell the apostle about what to happen. But the apostle them ain't believed them woman, because what they say ain't make no sense. But Peter get up and he run to the tomb. When he get there, he bend down and he look inside. He just see the linen grave clothes what they been used for wrap up the body of Jesus day. Nothing more. Then Peter gone back home to wonder what da happen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
now the Easter story is recorded in the Gospel of Luke, this time in English. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb taking the spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words. And on returning from the tomb, they told this to all the 11 and all of the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women who were with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them to be an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. And then he went home, amazed at what had happened. Sometimes I think the worst thing you can say about a person these days, the worst way to describe someone, is to call them naive. We can take all kinds of different names and bad words thrown at us, but we do not, above all things, want to be considered gullible, soft, naive. For then, of course, the world is going to run over us. We have to be tough and skeptical and scoffing. It's the only way to survive. And I think we often think this is something modern. Only we recent contemporary people are this way. But people have always been this way. In the Easter story, as we just heard it from Luke, the disciples, Jesus' closest friends, those that he's traveled with and taught for 3 years, that he's blessed and been with, when they received the news from the women, women who have also likely traveled with and been with Jesus for 3 years, women who, according to some accounts, have been bankrolling Jesus, women who were on Friday attentive enough to notice where the body of Jesus had been put, and now women who had woke up before sunrise in order to go care for Jesus' corpse and honor the site of his tomb. Those women, when they came to the apostles, they were dismissed as bringing an idle tale. No doubt about it, those women were hysterical. It was wishful thinking, naive nonsense. Now, I'm probably a little bit sensitive to this charge of the danger of being naive. Sometimes I think my job on Easter and maybe every Sunday is to stand up here and you feel like I'm trying to pitch you something naive. Oh, Easter tells us they all lived happily ever after. Isn't that cute and sweet and wonderful? Come back next week and we will talk about unicorns and rainbows and gnomes. Is the Christian message really trying to tell you to just put on some rose-colored glasses and look at a sweet and beautiful world? I don't think so. Not at all, in fact. Christianity is actually brutally realistic about the world. We know that people disagree. We know that people disappoint us. If you hang out here long enough, we will disappoint and hurt you. Churches fight. Terrible things happen to good people. It's just the way things are. Or let's look just momentarily, more specifically, at the life of Jesus, born into a barn with a price on his head, a few days old, and he's already fleeing for his life as a refugee. Or Friday, we rehearsed a story all about brutal torture and humiliation and being executed in one of the most gruesome ways possible. If you like realism, the Bible is full of it, and especially the story of Jesus. But let me also just for a moment put in a good word for sweetness and gentleness and being positive. You know, when I was young and we'd decide what movies to go to, I would say things like, well, I wanted to have a message. Something provocative, thoughtful, a drama. Now that I'm not so young and life seems bleak enough without seeing it in the movies, we ask each other, are we going to laugh? Or I think of a good friend's young son, about 35 years old, and we've known this young man since he's been 3 or 4 years old, who just last week was diagnosed with an aggressive acute form of leukemia. And when I look on Facebook as people send him messages, almost all of the messages, especially from cancer survivors, are stay positive, be bright, be strong. And it doesn't come across as cheap and shallow sentimentality. In fact, I think there's even real medical scientific proof that those who have this positive outlook do better in times of trial. So maybe what you're thinking, I know where this is going. He's telling us that one of our lenses should be rose-colored and optimistic, and the other should be sort of dark and realistic. And then we can get through life. Here's the thing. That is not at all the message of Easter. Not at all. Christ is risen tells us to put on an entirely different set of glasses, to start looking at the world through resurrection lenses. And that isn't one that's rose and one that's dark or two of either. It's an entirely different way of looking at the world. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is so big, so unimaginable, so mysterious, so wild, it is beyond any other way of looking at life. It's not as simple as good wins over evil. It's a totally different ball game. And we catch some of that even in the story. The women, when they get there, are, it tells us, perplexed. And then they are terrified. Basically, they have no software to process the information that they are receiving. There's just no way to fathom it. No points of reference to what is going on. Now, we have 2,000 years of advantage. It doesn't surprise you to come here this morning and be told that Christ is risen. The surprise part is over.
But really, if we are to catch even a bit of the magnitude of what the resurrection is, it should still perplex us, confuse us, and possibly even terrify us. As soon as we think we understand the resurrection, that we can explain it, then we have tamed it and trivialized it so that it is nothing more than an idle tale. Now I'm going to sound a bit kind of fussy and persnickety here, but just bear with me. I often wish that way early on, about when they were starting to say, Christ is risen indeed, some wise Christian would have taken the word resurrection and put one of those little T's in a circle. Trademark. This is our word. Because now we throw the word resurrection around in all sorts of different ways. We hear so-and-so resurrected his career. Hobbyists resurrect old cars. A couple resurrects their marriage. I have nothing but gratitude and honor toward doctors and EMTs that bring people back who are truly dead. But none of those things are resurrection. You might want to call them renewing or reviving or resuscitating. But resurrection is our word. Resurrection means coming back in a way that is radically and wildly different than before, and in a way of life that will never end. And folks, there has been one and only one resurrection so far. And that's what we are here to celebrate. So the message of Easter isn't be a little bit hopeful and be a little bit realistic. Have one rose-colored glass and the other dark. Maybe you can be a wary optimist or a hopeful realist. No. The message today is that the resurrection changes everything. In such unimaginable ways, it is hard for us to wrap our hands and our minds and our hearts around it. How do we live with resurrection-colored glasses? What does that even mean? And here comes another sort of counterintuitive twist, something unpredictable, perhaps. I've just spent the last few minutes trying to tell you how big and wild and gigantic and life universe altering the resurrection is. And now I need to tell you that it comes into the world in the smallest, most subtle, quiet ways that lots of people don't even see it. Wouldn't you want to say, well, something this big, if it's really as big as you say it is, Steve, well, then shouldn't it express itself by making world peace, curing cancer? Why can't aliens, friendly aliens, come down and share with us all sorts of technologies that would solve all our problems? Then maybe I would believe the universe had been changed. But instead, to wear resurrection-colored glasses is not necessarily to look for the big and the flashy, but look for the small and the quiet among us. And again, we get clues. We're taught this already in the stories of Jesus, where we find out a child sharing his lunch can change the world. A woman weeping is the resurrection breaking into the world. We find a cloddish fisherman who goes on to be the leader of this dynamic world-changing movement and eventually is killed for his convictions. I guess they didn't all live happily ever after. But we see unpredictable and wildly unimaginable twists. and they may be a clue that resurrection is among us. Maybe even a bit like the day of Easter itself that jumps all over the calendar. Maybe that's a clue to this wild unpredictability of it all. April 16th this year, I believe it's April 1st next year. Unexpected reversals. Having coffee and donuts before church rather than after church. Or pizza lunch on the fourth Sunday rather than the third. No, maybe those aren't such signs of resurrection. Wherever the downtrodden and the ignored and the outsiders are suddenly lifted up and valued, you can be sure resurrection is among us. Whenever you encounter somehow unexpected mercy, you have resurrection lenses on. Whenever you feel like love has to be depleted, empty, done, but somehow you are able to love relentlessly, you know that resurrection is with us. And when you can see tiny burning embers of hope where everybody else just sees ashes of despair, there too you say, I am seeing resurrection among us. That is not naivete, that is not realism, that is resurrection. And surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, we often catch a glimpse of resurrection around death. Not because death is avoided, not because our loved one just sneaks through. No, whether it's on death row in a prison or an oncology unit in a hospital, we still go through death. But we sense, we know that the risen Christ tells us there is a love that is stronger than death and a love that is longer than death. Resurrection, this enormous, cosmic, universal, altering, inexplicable event, and occasionally we catch a glimpse of it in the humblest, quietest, most obscure places. As you may know, my aunt Betty Brunsting died in January. And Betty was a teacher full of wisdom and good little sayings like teachers are. And one of her favorites may help us just catch where we are to look for resurrection. She would say often to her classes near the end, "Go forth to do great things." And I don't know if that was realism or naivete. But then she would add, "Or do small things greatly." Do small things greatly. And when we do that, we know that resurrection is among us, and we are looking through resurrection-colored glasses. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Amen. Beloved, let us now stand and say together with the church throughout the ages what we believe and what unites us using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us lift up our hearts and minds to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, may the songs we sing and the chants we say fill our lungs and our minds and our hearts with the breath of your Spirit, the breath of life, the breath that renews, the breath of resurrection, so that while we celebrate that Jesus rose, Jesus lives, Jesus is among us, that we might in our own ways see resurrection, know resurrection, share resurrection today and each day. By your Holy Spirit, allow us to see through resurrection-colored glasses, to find hope where others see none, to know a love that is stronger than death, to raise up those that are downcast and despairing. Our world, O Lord, seems to carry so few signs of resurrection, so many places of unspeakable things, bloodshed and cruelty and hunger and disease around the world and in lonely, empty nursing home rooms. We ask you to be bigger and wilder and beyond what we could hope or ask for. But we do ask that we would play a part, not simply in seeing resurrection, but in sharing it. We pray for your church today, the churches of Pella, the churches around the world, churches in Egypt that grieve, our friends in Turkey and Chiapas and Taiwan and Romania. May the alleluias that we all sing please and bring glory to you and bring good news to our world. We pray for those who grieve today, that even in their grief, the message of Easter may bring hope and comfort. We pray for those today who are ill, hospitalized, recovering. We think especially of Carol, of Dave, and Artie. Hear now, in a few moments of silence, those prayers we hold in the deepest parts of our hearts. We pray for our children and our grandchildren. We pray for our parents, our spouses, our siblings, that as much as Easter is universe-altering, that in these, our closest relationships, we ask for your blessing, for resurrection to be present, for hope to sustain us. Indeed, we do pray with hope. We pray with persistence. We pray boldly, because we pray it all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our risen Lord, and the one who gave us this prayer to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now with joy and with gratitude, let us bring our offerings to the Lord.
Offer these gifts to you, O God, aware that our lives are filled with gifts from you, gifts of love and substance and life. Receive these gifts. In and through them may you be honored and known and glorified through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now may the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and rest upon you always. Go in peace. Amen.